Welcome again to our Tuesday evening teaching sessions, an opportunity to think together and to converse together, even though we can't do that in reality. I know a number of you have been feeding back different things, so thank you for that, and just encourage others to do the same. It's great to have that sense of a dialogue going on as we look at these issues that challenge. I guess for all of us, we're influenced by all sorts of different things. We all like to think we're original thinkers, but the truth is that most of us have been molded in one way or another. And of course, what we're trying to do with these issues that challenge is just have another look at them. Maybe for some of them, you haven't looked at them for a long time. And it's really good just to go back and say, okay, well, what is it exactly Scripture is trying to tell us? And how does that work in terms of what society is trying to persuade us of? We live in a media outlet age. We have so much available for us that it's difficult to avoid just having that input into our lives, and it's good to kind of counterbalance that with a good look at Scriptures again to see how we want to address some of these issues that challenge. Last week we thought about Christian peace, and I guess I tried to contrast that with the kind of peace that often people talk about outside of the church, and sometimes, if we're honest, within the church, and to see that Christian peace, shalom, embedded in that wonderful Jewish word, wholeness, really does bring us a whole new insight into where peace is found, true peace is found, and how that might be something that we live with and experience for ourselves, that inner peace that passes all human understanding. And I think we also had an opportunity to view some of those things that might well take away from that internal peace and cause us to become quite fearful or anxious. So we had a chance to look at that too. It's often said that BBC is full of repeats. Well, I'm going to do a repeat in one sense in these next two sessions. About four years ago as a church, we had the opportunity to think about creation and evolution. I looked at it in five sessions, and maybe a number of you were able to attend those. And I really felt it would be difficult to look at issues that challenge without reviewing those again and going back to have a look at creation and evolution. And so in the next two sessions, that's my intention. I hope that's not too much of a repeat for some of you. I'm sure it's always good to revisit things, and maybe this time you'll get a better understanding of what I was trying to say. If you're new to these teaching sessions, then of course this will come across as quite fresh for you. And I hope this again gives us a chance to think about those two critical and key understandings, how we understand our belief in a creator God in a scientific age, in a scientific world. I think it's really important for us as Christians to learn how to have grown-up conversations. Sometimes churches have not been so keen on allowing people to think for themselves. And there are historic reasons why that might have been the case. But I think more and more church leaders are realizing that it's really important for people to have an opportunity to think for themselves and to have a grown-up conversation without fear of anyone trying to suppress what they're actually trying to say. And I hope we'll be able to do that in these next two sessions. Just to add to my previous comments, there were five sessions with this particular course. And if you wanted me to say more, I'd be very happy to do that and perhaps introduce another couple of sessions to add to these two. But let me know if you think you would find that helpful. Of course, how Christians view creation, their understanding of creation, and their understanding of evolution, of course, varies enormously within the church. That's why we need to have grown-up conversations. And of course, there are many within the Christian church today who believe that the accounts that you find in primarily in Genesis chapter 1 and Genesis chapter 2 are very literal and historical accounts about the processes of creation. In other words, not only are they given us an understanding of where life has come from, but they're also primarily helping us to understand how that all came to be. Now, of course, many Christians who hold that particular view very strongly would ally themselves to what's known as the young Earth creationists. Young Earth creationists are those people who believe that the universe, as we now understand it, has only been in existence for something like 10,000 years. So they have a very young Earth creationist view in that sense. Now, of course, if you're one of them, that's absolutely fine. And I hope these sessions will prove to be just another chance to think about your particular view, your particular stance, and then, of course, to view how others might see it a little bit differently. Of course, many Christians today have been very challenged by science to think through these issues again and to bring perhaps a better understanding in terms of scientific insight, one that doesn't undermine core beliefs. In fact, quite the opposite, seems to add validity to them. Again, just being open to hear what people have to say who are coming from a slightly different perspective. I guess many Christians have gone underground with the whole issue of creation and evolution, preferring to kind of ignore the issues and just hope that no one ever raises it with us. And of course, people will raise that particular issue with us because media plays enormously on it. To be a creationist today, it's assumed you have certain beliefs, and of course those beliefs are unpalatable in our modern scientific cultured society. And of course that's an issue for us and one that we're often going to be challenged about. I guess for some Christians, they feel very confused about the whole issue, maybe even unsure about the whole thing. How do you work with a fundamental belief in a creator God and also then take seriously what science is saying, what it's continuing to bring to us? How do you bring those two things into alignment? Well, what I hope to do tonight is to show that that is indeed possible and how we might go about that. I also need to add that some Christians have lost their faith simply because the evidence for evolutionary processes have been so strong for them that it's brought them to the point where they no longer believe in God. My own understanding is that that's not necessary, and that we can work in a very different way to that. And I hope that's what we're being able to do in this particular session this evening. So let's set out some parameters for our discussion. I need to say, first of all, that I'm not a scientist. If anything, I see myself as a theologian, and I see all of us as theologians, because all of us are simply trying to grapple with Christian doctrine and scripture in a way that enables us to live in this post scientific era when people are continuing to find out new things about the very essence of our universe, or even universes, of course, today. I'm not a scientist, but I value science. I value its insight, and I value what it contributes in the way that it helps me to think through my own beliefs about how life first began, how all things came into being. I guess the scientific community does contain people who have very closed minds as far as creation is concerned. It's also true, of course, to say that the Christian community has those who have closed minds in terms of an evolutionary understanding. So there are extremes on both sides, but I think there's a lot of middle ground where we can work together and dialogue together and think things through together. I don't want this session in any way to undermine anyone's own views, just simply to strengthen them, to make them more robust as we seek to live out our faith. And of course, inevitably, people will want to know, what is it exactly we believe about the origins of our universe? How did life first begin? The first thing I want to say about the creation stories is that they're not just simply contained within Genesis chapter 1 and Genesis chapter 2. I think the Bible, the biblical record, wants us to understand that creation is an ongoing process. God didn't create and then allow the rest of things to unfold in their own way. God didn't have one go at creation and then release it and it had to get on and find its own way. God has not abandoned his universe, his world, and continues to work creatively, within the universe and the boundaries that have been set by scientific understanding. Of course, that's not to say that God can't go beyond scientific understanding, the core fundamental beliefs that govern our universe. But of course, mostly God works within them and does so wonderfully and so in such a creative way. So we haven't got a view of a God who winds things up and lets them go on by themselves. We have a God here who is constantly creating and sustaining life. Thankfully, he is. Otherwise, we wouldn't be engaged in this particular dialogue this evening. We have in Genesis, I think, a backcloth to God's ongoing creative work. And of course, what it does, the whole of Scripture, is as it views the God who brings all things into being, who then continues to create and sustain the very fundamentals of life, we also have that long view too presented to us of God who's going to recreate, that one day there will be a new heaven and a new earth. But let's have a little think about Genesis chapter 1 and Genesis chapter 2. I'm going to read Genesis chapter 1 because I absolutely love it. And I find it such a beautiful piece of writing and gives great insight into this amazing creator God. Genesis chapter 1, beginning with verse 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now the earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. And God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. God saw that the light was good, and he separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. And God said, "Let there be an expanse between the waters to separate water from water." So God made the expanse and separated the water under the expanse from the water above it. And it was so. God called the expanse sky, and there was evening, and there was morning, the second day. And God said, "Let the water under the sky be gathered in one place, and let dry ground appear." And it was so. God called the dry ground land, and the gathered waters he called seas. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let the land produce vegetation, seed-bearing plants, and trees of the field that bear fruit with their seed in it, according to their various kinds." And it was so. The land produced vegetation, plants bearing seeds according to their kinds, and trees bearing fruit with seed in it according to their kinds. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the third day. And God said, "Let there be lights in the expanse of the sky to separate the day from the night, and let them serve as signs to mark seasons and days and years. And let them be lights in the expanse of the sky to give light on earth." And it was so. God made two great lights, the greater light to govern the day, and the lesser light to govern the night. He also made the stars. God set them in the expanse of the sky to give light on the earth, to govern the day and the night, and to separate light from darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was morning and evening, the fourth day. And God said, "Let the waters teem with living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the expanse of the sky." So God created the great creatures of the sea and every living and moving thing with which the water teems, according to their kinds, and every winged bird according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. God blessed them and said, "Be fruitful and increase in number, and fill the water in the seas, and let the birds increase on earth." And there was evening, and there was morning, the fifth day. And God said, "Let the land produce living creatures according to their kinds, livestock, creatures that move along the ground, and wild animals, each according to its kind." And it was so. God made the wild animals according to their kinds, the livestock according to their kinds, and all creatures that move along the ground according to their kinds. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, in our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air, over the livestock, over all the earth, and over all creatures that move along the ground." So God created a man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him, male and female, he created them. God blessed them and said to them, "Be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air and over every living creature that moves on the ground." Then God said, I give every seed-bearing plant on the face of the whole earth, and every tree that has fruit with seed in it. They will be yours for food. And to all the beasts of the earth, and all the birds of the air, and all the creatures that move on the ground, everything that has the breath of life in it, I give every green plant for food. And it was so. God saw all he has made, and it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. I think the first thing we need to understand from Genesis chapter 1 and Genesis chapter 2 is, in fact, you don't have one account of creation. You have two accounts. One is contained mostly in Genesis chapter 1 through to chapter 2 and verse 4, and then again from Genesis 2, 5 forward. So we have two quite different accounts of creation. Where they differ primarily is in the order of creation. Of course, what you can try and do is to cut and paste them and to see if they fit together somehow. I would suggest that doesn't work, primarily because that's not their purpose. They were never meant to be treated in that way. So this raises a question for us, and it asks an important question. The writers of the two accounts differ. Does that suggest then that the order that they place things in didn't really matter to them? It wasn't as important as we might first have believed. In fact, I would suggest they're not trying to give us an order of creative events, but they're simply trying to tell us what's really important about these two stories. And that will help us, and I think this is their purpose, to understand where it all began and how we are where we are today. And of course, that raises one of the most important questions that anyone can ask about any piece of literature. What was the author's intentions? What was their purpose in writing down the things that they did? I guess if you buy a cookbook or a car maintenance book, you wouldn't expect the cookbook to contain every single recipe there ever has been and will be. Nor, if you bought a maintenance book about car maintenance, well, you wouldn't expect that to have everything about every car. And yet we seem to expect Genesis chapter 1 and 2 to do just that. We expect to find there everything there is to be said about creation. And it doesn't seem that that's their purpose. There is so much more that could have been said, but for the moment, the writers are focusing in on what they see as being the most important things. So in other words, Genesis chapter 1 and 2 are asking theological questions. You could say they're asking philosophical questions. They're really asking the why question. Why is our world as it is? Why have some things gone well and some things clearly gone pear-shaped? These important why questions are at the very heart of what the authors here are trying to address. That's what they're trying to tell us. They're asking important questions about God's relationship to his creation and, of course, God's relationship to us. The authors are not trying to give us a scientific account. They're not trying to address primarily the how question. The how question is the scientific question. The why question is the theological question. And both of them need to be addressed. They're both very important. But the authors of Genesis chapter 1 and 2 are not trying to do both. They're primarily focused on the why questions. We live in a modern age. We live in a modern era of scientific understanding. But we need to remember that modern science did not exist until we reached the modern age. So people who were writing down these accounts of creation were very different in their thinking and their understanding. And so they're not trying to address the kind of questions that we have in the 21st century. They're not at all concerned about a sequence of events, putting things into order, doing it chronologically. It's the wrong thing to ask of them. All they're simply doing is they're attempting to answer that why question. Why are we where we are? And how did it all begin in a theological sense? You see, if you ask the right questions, you end up with the right answers. If you ask the wrong questions, you end up with the wrong answers. So what are those questions that they're trying to address? What kind of answers are they giving to us, to those why questions, those theological, philosophical questions? Well, firstly, they clearly want to say to us that behind the origins of the universe is a creator God. And then secondly, behind the origins of the universe, there is a creative purpose. It's not all accidental. There's a purpose that's being that is constantly unfolding. The third thing they want to tell us is that through the universe, God has shown something of himself. He's revealed something of who he is. Fourthly, they want to tell us that behind the origins of all life as we know it on Earth is a creator God. The fifth thing they want us to grasp is that God is in relationship with all that he has made. And then finally, they simply want to tell us that humans are uniquely made in God's image, and therefore can uniquely enjoy a particular kind of relationship with God. Those are the fundamental questions, the why questions, that the writers are trying to address to us. Those are the important things. And if we focus on those things, then we really get to understand what the author's trying to tell us. And these are significant and wonderful things that they're trying to reveal to us. Truth is such a big word. Of course, truth can be based on a historical and literal thing, something that's actually happened. But of course, we recognize in life that there's another kind of truth, equally true, but it doesn't necessarily imply that historically or in a literal way, it's happened in that particular way. It's valid and as important, but it's not literal and it's not historical. When we say to somebody, oh, what you just said really helped me. It was so true and I'm so grateful. It's changed my thinking. It's given me a new understanding. Well, we're not necessarily saying to that person that what they've said happened historically or in a literal sense. We're simply saying that the truth they spoke has touched our lives, and it's very significant for us. We're very comfortable with the idea of parables. We find them in Scripture, not just in the New Testament, the Gospels, but we find them throughout Scripture. We don't like the word myth so much because it seems to suggest that something isn't true. Well, that's not the true meaning of myth at all. But let's stay with the idea of a parable, maybe because it's a little bit easier for us to accept. So what I'm suggesting here is that when we come to Genesis 1 and 2, that the authors are writing something that is absolutely 100% true. It's the inspired word of God. But it's not a literal or a historic account of how creation comes about, how it all began, and how it continues to unfold in our world today. So what were the authors trying to do? What were their inspired insights that they bring to us? Well, let's ask the question first of all, who exactly wrote Genesis 1 and 2? Well, of course, traditionally, they've very much been viewed as part of the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Old Testament, the Jewish scriptures, as they were at that time. And, of course, the law books, which were incorporated within them. Traditionally, of course, it was believed that Moses wrote all five books. I guess mostly today, scholars would say that has been called into question, and probably would argue that those stories that we have there have gone through an oral tradition when they were passed down by word of mouth. And they were probably written down in one form or another and gathered up by a school of writers after the exile of the Jews in Babylon. Now, not everyone agrees with that, and I'm not asking everyone to agree with that. I'm just simply explaining how people see things quite differently. Now, for some, the fact that there's this huge, long process between what they perceive as happening and when it was actually written down is a problem. For me, it just makes the fact that that has come to us as the revealed word of God, the inspired word of God, the truth, even more incredible, not less credible. That God's hand has been on these truths right since that moment when things began to go through those creative processes. So I don't think it makes them feel less inspired. For me personally, I think it makes them feel more inspired. And I think that's what the Bible is trying to do. It's bringing together a collection of parables that have been passed down from generation to generation, protected as the word, the inspired word of God, and eventually written down much, much later. And of course, that's very exciting. And it just adds to the power and the significance of these stories. Not literal stories, not historical stories in the sense that we're seeing there a literal account of the processes of creation, but the truth about creation. And those truths I've already tried to explain this evening. Well, next time we chat and think together again, we're going to be looking at evolution, which of course will help us to have a rounded picture of creation and evolution together. And that will give us then the opportunity to think some more and to begin to wrestle with some of those things that we've had the opportunity to think about this evening. So thank you again for joining with us. I hope you found it engaging tonight. I'd be really interested to hear what you have to say. And as I said before, we're having an adult conversation here, and we're going to do that with as much grace as we can muster, as we see how Christians sometimes see things differently, and it's good to have a view at where others are coming from in that whole process. So thank you for joining with us.